Now, it is my pleasure to introduce a good friend of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, Dr. Stephen Trout. He is a professor of English and chair of the Department of English at the University of Alabama. His interdisciplinary research focuses on the cultural representations of war through various mediums of art and literature. He has paid special attention to the memoirs of American doughboys as well as their memorialization through history. He is the author of several books, including On the Battlefield of Memory, The First World War and American Remembrance, 1919 to 1941, and the editor or co-editor of multiple volumes, including most recently Portraits of Remembrance, Painting, Memory, and the First World War. Trout was also instrumental and the republication of John Lewis Barclay's memoir, Scarlet Fields, which I know is a favorite for many of you here in the auditorium. He is a Kansas City Medal of Honor recipient whose collection we proudly have within, whose objects and artifacts we proudly have within our collection. And this evening, if you are on site and are here for the reception, the main gallery will be open. You can go across the Paul Sunderland Glass Bridge over those poppies, and you can take a look at that Medal of Honor. It's over on the West Gallery, and you can talk to any of our volunteers, some of whom are here. You can generally tell them by their red lanyards. They might be able to help you find some of those as well. Thank you if you are one of our volunteers. Thank you if you are one of our members, and thank you for all being here, both on site and online, for our next conversation. Will you please join me in welcoming Dr. Stephen Trout?
Thank you, Laura. Well, we're about to move as far from the geopolitical and military history of the Middle East as we possibly can. I want to thank Laura Vogt for inviting me to speak at the symposium, and I want to thank James Taub for his help setting up my PowerPoint presentation. Also, I want to recognize Jonathan Casey and the wonderful people who work in the archives here at the memorial. I spent all a happy day yesterday working in the archives and discovered all kinds of treasures that I plan to use in a book that I'm writing now about the sinking of the SS Tuscania and its commemoration over the span of a century. The talk I'm going to give offers no real original research. Instead, it's a synthesis of some existing sources in an effort to make some points about John J. Pershing and also the nature of American memory of the First World War. There are three sources in particular that I want to recognize which were really invaluable as I put this together. The first one is a book that I think most of you in the audience are probably familiar with, Donald Smy's wonderful biography of Pershing, Pershing General of the Armies from 1986. Which I think still stands quite well as one of the best books on Pershing. And then more recently, Thomas H. Connor's War and Remembrance, The Story of the American Battle Monuments Commission, published in 2018, a book that really illuminates Pershing's role as the head of the American Battle Monuments Commission's head board in a way that we haven't really seen before. And then last but not least, a wonderful master's thesis by a student named Andrew S. Walgren, who was at the University of South Carolina in 2016, a thesis titled The Forgotten Man of Washington, The Pershing Memorial, and the Battle Over Military Memorialization. So, the title of my talk, Losing on the Battlefield of Memory, John J. Pershing's Remembrance Travails, might seem surprising to many of you. After all, John J. Pershing was one of the most celebrated, one of the most lionized Americans of the early 20th century. He was an icon of American masculinity and strength, whose visage was instantly recognizable to the American public and to all of the soldiers who served under his command. Pershing's ramrod straight posture, his rugged good looks, His martial bearing made him an instantly recognizable figure both abroad and on the home front. Pershing was featured in literally dozens of different World War I propaganda posters, including the three that I featured here, two of which promote the War Saving Stamps program. The one in the middle is actually an advertisement for a propaganda film made with U.S. Signal Corps footage that was released by the War Department in 1918. Pershing was robustly memorialized after the war. Hardly a town or city in the United States doesn't have a Pershing Boulevard or a Pershing Place or a Pershing Street. Schools from coast to coast were named after John J. Pershing, including this example from St. Joseph, Missouri. And, of course, we have the epicenter of John J. Pershing commemoration. We have his boyhood home, lovingly preserved in Laclede, Missouri, where we also have other commemorative trappings, including the statue of Pershing that you see on the right. However, I'm going to argue that Pershing's image, his popularity with the American public, fades steadily, really from the early 1920s onward, and in ways that I think are quite revealing, that tell us a lot about how the First World War becomes, quote unquote, America's forgotten war. So to make this point, I'm going to pull together three strands. First, I'm going to talk about the 1931 publication of John J. Pershing's My Experiences in the World War, his account of his leadership of the American Expeditionary Forces, a book that was a critical and commercial failure, by and large. Secondly, I'm going to look at his leadership of the American Battle Monuments Commission over the two-decade interwar period and consider the successes and failures of the memorial enterprises that he oversaw. Then I'm going to talk about how Pershing himself was commemorated in the nation's capital through an effort that dragged on from 1948 until 1983. So let's turn to the first of these. Pershing's My Experiences in the World War was published in 1931. It received the Pulitzer Prize in 1932, a recognition, in my opinion, more of Pershing's generalship than his ability as a writer. Pershing was a horrible writer. And if any of you have read his two-volume work, if you actually made it all the way to the end, you'll instantly recognize that. Pershing realized that writing was not his forte, and I think it's fair to say that during the 10-year period from 1921 until 1931, when he chipped away at his memoirs, he hated every single minute of it. He remarked to George Marshall one time that he would rather fight four wars than write an account of one. If you look at his correspondence with family members and friends, he complains endlessly about what torture this writing experience has become for him and how worthless the finished product will probably be. Now, to add to Pershing's angst, I would argue, is a considerable anxiety of influence. And so if you'll bear with me for a moment, I want to leave Pershing in World War I and go back to another more celebrated and certainly more readable two-volume work that I suspect many of you have read. I'm referring, of course, to the two-volume memoir by this gentleman, okay? Which looks like this when it was published in 1885. I'm referring, of course, to the personal memoirs of U.S. Grant, which in the opinion of Grant's most recent biographer, Ron Chernow, is, quote, the foremost military memoir in the English language. The story of how Grant composed this work is justly famous, and I think it was part of the appeal of the project when it was finally finished in 1885. I think most of you know the story. Grant, in 1884, was diagnosed with throat cancer and was given just months to live. Ever gullible, he had lost the family fortune to a fraudulent investment scheme, and he was worried that he would leave his wife, Julia, in penury. And so he set out to write his account of his leadership of the federal forces in the American Civil War. He was assisted in this effort by none other than Mark Twain. Mark Twain had bankrolled his own publishing house by this point in his career, known as the Charles L. Webster & Company. And Twain, of course, was a horrible businessman with awful instincts. But for once, he was right on target. He recognized that Grant's book would go big and that there would be a tremendous audience for it. And so Twain supported Grant during the final year of Grant's life in every way he could to see that this book was published. During the last 8 to 9 months of his life, Ulysses S. Grant did two things. He wrote every single day and he suffered. His tumor in his throat grew to the size, as one journalist described it, as two fists held together. Grant's weight dropped down to about 90 pounds. He couldn't eat without pain and without difficulty. He couldn't sleep at night. He was in absolute agony. And for Grant during this period, the one salvation, the one thing that he looked forward to every day was the opportunity to work on his memoirs. Twain was struck by the fluency of Grant's writing. Grant apparently didn't need to revise anything. It just flowed from his pen. When the book was finally published, and I should point out that Grant finished it just 1 week before he died in 1885, when the book was finally published by Mark Twain's publishing house, it became, many scholars believe, the second best-selling American book of the 19th century, second only to Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin. It was a runaway success. It sold 300,000 copies within the first 2 years, and Julia Grant received $400,000 in royalties. If you translate that, into our currency today, that's more than $11 million. So it was by any measure an impressive publication. In contrast, my experiences in the World War was a critical and commercial disaster. Critics maligned the book, and with just cause. They pointed out that it was tedious, that it was dull, that it was all but unreadable in sections and incoherent. Part of the reason for this is that Pershing, against the advice of a number of people he consulted, including Dwight D. Eisenhower, who was working for the American Battle Monuments Commission shortly before this book came out, he decided to approach his war experience using a journal format. And this means that if Pershing tells you what he was doing at a particular point in 1917, he covers all 10 of the things that he was working on, and then unfortunately, they show up at other points later in the narrative. And so this gives you a great sense of just how much multitasking Pershing was doing during the First World War. It gives you a sense that his command was far more complicated and difficult than even Grant's. And I think that claim can be made, but it results in a text that is all but unreadable. And this was pointed out by a number of book reviewers. Commercially, it did not do well at all. Pershing's publisher, the unfortunate Frederick Stokes Company, thought that the book would go so big that it decided to print more than 50,000 copies for the first edition. About a year later, it still had most of those 50,000 copies. Now, there were all kinds of reasons for this failure, which I'll talk about in a moment, but I want to show you just how desperate Pershing's publisher became. This is a tipped-in sheet, well, not tipped-in, it's actually bound into the book, but you can tell that it was added later. This is a sheet that contains a dedication to an individual American veteran of the First World War. In this case, a gentleman named Jesse Tarr. This is in my personal copy of my experiences in the World War, which, believe me, is not a regular on my nightstand. And so Jesse Tarr apparently responded to some ad, which probably said something to the effect of, here is your one and only chance to get to have your own personalized copy of my experiences in the World War, where your name can be proudly displayed above the signature, the facsimile signature, I should point out, of John J. Pershing. And then we get this paragraph in the middle that describes, no matter what you did during the First World War, maybe you were with the Service of Supply, maybe you were in a combat unit, maybe you never went overseas, you still did your part, and you still can regard your service with honor. This is a great advertising ploy that really didn't help the sales of the book at all, but it shows you the links to which the publisher would go. It's also ironic and contradictory because Pershing dedicated the book to the unknown soldier, and yet the publisher quickly figured out that we'll make an appeal to known soldiers, and maybe we'll get better sales as a result. Well, what went wrong with my experiences in the World War? How could a general who was so, the general of the armies, the second military figure in American history to bear that title, and a contender for the Republican nomination in the presidential race in 1920, how could Pershing's star have fallen so low? Well, there are a number of explanations. First of all, we're now in the midst of the Great Depression in 1931. The floor has fallen out from the American economy, people have less disposable income, and this two-volume set of my experiences in the World War was quite expensive. It retailed in 1931 initially for $10 per set, which was a lot of money. It was not helped by the fact that it appeared on the heels of what's referred to by scholars as the war book boom, sort of an international explosion of literary interest in the First World War. But when you look carefully at the war book boom, what you see is that readers were not particularly interested in accounts by military leaders. What the generals had to offer was not of great interest among a popular readership. Peyton March, Robert Lee Buller, James Harbord, Newton Baker, Ferdinand Foch, Erich von Falkenhayn, just to name a few, were all major military leaders or civilian leaders who released lengthy memoirs of their experiences in the war. None of those books became bestsellers, and most of them were forgotten in terms of American memory of World War I almost as soon as they were published. What the public preferred were books that dealt with the experiences of ordinary people in wartime. And this is best illustrated by the most successful war book of the period, in fact, the most successful war novel of all time. And I'm referring, of course, to All Quiet on the Western Front by Erich Maria Remarque. The English translation by A.H. Wien reaches the American public in 1929. The book becomes a runaway bestseller. It's based on the German text, Invest in Nix Neues. And by the early 1970s, I don't have figures that are from the 21st century, but by the early 1970s, this book had sold 8 million copies worldwide, and it had been translated into 32 different languages. It is an extraordinary success. And if you've read All Quiet on the Western Front, and of course every single one of you has, that's the beauty of this audience, you know that this book is as far from issues involving military and political leadership as it could possibly be. In fact, one criticism that someone could make of All Quiet on the Western Front in terms of its realism or lack thereof is that there are hardly ever any officers mentioned in this text. Officers show up in maybe two scenes. You have the impression that Paul Baumer and Kaczynski and the other main characters are in a squad operating entirely on their own, independent of any military authority on the Western Front. So this book is absolutely indifferent to issues of leadership in wartime. But the other problem, I think, goes even deeper. I think there was skepticism by 1931 on the part of the American reading public about the wartime exploits of supposedly great and powerful men. Their stock had fallen as a result of the First World War. We know that opinion polls in the early 1930s, polls that were taken not long after my experiences in the World War was published, we know from these opinion polls that most Americans felt by this point that in America's entrance into the First World War had been a mistake, that the nation had had no business going to war with Imperial Germany. So for all of these reasons, Pershing's memoirs are a memory failure, if you will, a failure to interest the American public in his personal experience, and also a failure of his larger vision of American success in the war to take root with a readership. So let me turn to the second strand. Let's talk about Pershing's leadership of the American Battle Monuments Commission. The American Battle Monuments Commission was founded in 1923 by an act of Congress. It was set up as an organization to oversee the design, construction, and maintenance of all American war memorials and war cemeteries located abroad. Warren G. Harding appointed John J. Pershing to the commission, and then he was elected to the head position by the other members of the board. For a long time, scholars have speculated that Pershing didn't really play much of a role in the deliberations of the commission. His title was largely was titular. He was not actually interested, and he probably used the trips that he took to France under the auspices of the American Battle Monuments Commission as great opportunities to see his mistress, Micheline Resco. But as it turns out, and as Connor reveals in his recent history of the American Battle Monuments Commission, Pershing was intensely focused on the commemorative agenda of the commission, which he helped shape. He was demanding, forceful, at times imperious, when various commemorative schemes were put forward that he did not approve. He fought back, and he usually got his way. So I think we need to understand many of the memorials, American memorials and cemeteries and chapels that we see on the Western Front today as being a legacy not only of the ABMC, but really of Pershing's vision of the shapes that this commemoration should take. And there were two assumptions that Pershing and his fellow commissioners arrived at very early in their planning process. They basically agreed that commemoration on the battlefields of Europe would look nothing like this. And these, of course, are not memorials located on an American battlefield in the former Western Front. These are memorials atop Cemetery Ridge at Gettysburg. Gettysburg has more than 2,000 monuments. Enormous state-level monuments, monuments to individual soldiers, monuments to regiments, and so forth. They absolutely encrust the landscape, as you all know. This was not the sort of aesthetic that John J. Pershing wanted to see applied in Europe. And there were really two reasons for this. First, Pershing realized that the French would find this sort of commemorative carpeting of the battlefield, if you will, as being deeply offensive. America in the Great War lost about 116,000 people. France, of course, lost, depending on the estimate, anywhere from 1.75 million to nearly 2 million. So given the size of French losses in comparison with those of the United States, Pershing felt it would be vulgar to have this sort of scattered commemoration on the battlefield. Secondly, he believed very much in sending the message to the world through the ABMC's memorials that the United States had moved past sectional conflict, and the United States had become a fully unified, extremely powerful world superpower. And this was a message to be conveyed through the ABMC's memorials. These memorials emphasize federal power. They subordinate the interest of states, and they subordinate the interest of small military units to a larger narrative about American military success and power. Now, you can see just how streamlined the American Battle Monuments Commission's agenda became in comparison with those cluttered Civil War battlefields. If you look at this map from the 1930s, you can see that there were only 11 major memorials created by the ABMC in Europe. And there were only 8 major military cemeteries, one in England, one in Belgium, the rest in France. Each of those military cemeteries was accompanied by a chapel. And within that chapel, and the chapels vary in design, within that chapel is a list of the soldiers whose remains have never been identified. And so this was a consistent, programmatic approach to memorialization, and it was applied evenly to all of the sites where American soldiers had served. In 1934, in one of Pershing's publications that people often forget about, he outlined the achievements of the American Battle Monuments Commission. Now, even by 1934, not all of the overseas memorials had been completed yet or dedicated. In fact, the American Memorial on Montfaucon, the memorial to the American fighting in the Meuse-Argonne, would not be completed until 1937. This was probably part of the problem with these memorials, in fact, is that they were erected so long after the war, and as we'll see, in a place that was so inaccessible for most Americans. But in 1934, Pershing described them in the lead article of National Geographic for January of that year, and laid out what the commission had achieved and why Americans could celebrate and take satisfaction in these memorials. Well, what do these memorials look like? Well, most of you have probably visited them, but let me quickly show you some examples. Most of these photographs I've taken myself on recent visits to the American battlefields. This is probably my favorite American World War I memorial in Europe. I think it's absolutely magnificent. I think it's breathtaking. This, of course, is the memorial located on the summit of Hill 204 overlooking Chateau Thierry, and this is the Aisne-Marne Memorial. I learned when I was staying in a hotel in Chateau Thierry that the French locals have nicknamed this the Radiator. I thought that was perfect. It is a magnificent structure. It combines elements of classicism with elements of Egyptian revival. It should remind you, in fact, in part, of some of the architecture that you see here at the Liberty Memorial. A closer image, this is the side of the memorial that is facing to the west, facing toward Paris, facing toward the heart of France. And it's just wonderful. It has the list of places running along the top edge: Vaux, Fimay, Belleau Wood, where Americans fought in the summer of 1918 in the Aisne-Marne. And it also has the figures of the sister republics, the United States and France, brought together here as they were in the American Revolution, the United States symbolized by Columbia, the Republic of France symbolized by Marianne. On the other side of the memorial, facing east toward the German front lines, we have this extraordinary American eagle, and then in place, we have more place names across the top. There's Croix Rouge Farm, and then at the bottom, we have the list of American divisions that participated in combat in this region in the summer of 1918. This is the American Memorial atop the summit of Montfaucon, 60 meters in height, topped by the figure of Victory, looking out toward the former German positions. This Montfaucon is a prominence that can be seen easily 20, 30 miles away, and so this memorial just looms over the countryside. It could not be more impressive. This is the American Memorial that atop Mont Sec, which is the high point in the Saint-Mihiel sector. It's a memorial that is straightforwardly classical in design, very Jeffersonian. It would look at heart probably on the nation's mall. Now, Pershing had input into all of those designs. Obviously, he was not an architect, but they definitely reflected his aesthetic sensibilities, as well as those of the other commissioners. Pershing also had strong views on how the grave markers for individual soldiers should be designed. He insisted upon white stone, which he wanted to convey a theme of purity and eternity. He also insisted, because Pershing believed that American commemoration in Europe should be infused with religiosity, he insisted that the stones would take the shape of crucifixes in the case of Christian casualties, or a Star of David in the case of a Jewish fatality. The grave over here on the left, you will recognize as that of Joyce Kilmer, one of the most celebrated American fatalities of the Great War, the poet, of course, who died while serving in the 42nd Division and 165th Infantry. And it indicates below that he received the Croix de Guerre in recognition of his service. This is a photograph I did not take, but found online, and I think it's absolutely wonderful. It was probably taken by a drone. And it brings together many of the things that I believe make these ABMC memorials so imposing and beautiful and elegant. This, of course, is the Aisne-Marne Cemetery, located right on the edge of Belleau Wood. In fact, that's Belleau Wood itself that's over here on the left-hand side. That's just the edge of the woods. The woods go for nearly a solid mile. When I last visited Belleau Wood in 2018, I went too late in the afternoon and got lost at night. And I thought that was the perfect way to experience Belleau Wood. The grave markers are elegantly curved here. It creates just an absolutely stunning effect. The beautiful limestone chapel, which contains the list of the missing, is right there at the edge of the woods. Aesthetically, it's an absolutely extraordinary place. But I would argue that as beautiful as they are, as striking as they are, the ABMC's memorials completed in the 1920s and 30s were ultimately failures in terms of establishing any purchase in the imagination of the American public. These never became sites of living memory, not in the way that the ossuary did at Verdun for the French, or the way that the Thiepval Memorial did for the British on the Western Front, or the Menin Gate at Ypres. These American memorials were seldom frequented by American visitors in the 1920s and 30s. Again, the Great Depression had much to do with this, and they are seldom frequented today. You might look back over my photographs of these memorials, and you see that there's not another soul in sight. And if you go back and look at the photographs in that 1934 issue of National Geographic, you see exactly the same thing. Now, I think another issue that's in play here, which helps to explain why these never became living sites of memory, is that these memorials, magnificent though they are, did not reflect either the aesthetic sensibility or the ideological convictions of your average American veteran in the First World War. Many American veterans of the First World War probably would have preferred the cluttered style of commemoration that you saw in that image from Cemetery Ridge at Gettysburg. Because what mattered most to many individual veterans was their connection to their specific unit, where their regiment fought, where their company fought. This was the most important thing to many veterans. And many of them were not big fans of this scheme, which has a much more monolithic approach to commemoration, just one memorial per battlefield, and which emphasizes federal power and federal unity. In fact, one of the problems that bedeviled the ABMC when these memorials were created was what to do with the various regimental and divisional memorials that regimental and divisional societies had managed to slip onto these battlefields while the ABMC was still trying to figure out what its commemorative scheme would be. And so in some cases, these regimental or divisional memorials were removed at the request of the commission. In other instances, they were not. And the commission had to make it very clear that it would not be responsible for the upkeep of anything that it did not erect itself. That was not part of its commemorative agenda. The third strand I want to bring together in this talk is to talk a little bit about how John J. Pershing was himself commemorated in a memorial effort that lasted from 1948, the year of the general's death, until 1983, significantly the year after the National Vietnam Veterans Memorial, aka The Wall, was dedicated in Washington, D.C., based on that extraordinary design by Maya Lin. This, I believe, is a very revealing chapter in the history of Pershing's public image. After his death, there were multiple cries for appropriate memorialization of Pershing in Washington, D.C. Ultimately, the effort was taken up, appropriately enough, or ironically enough, by none other than the American Battle Monuments Commission. Now, there were two problems with this initiative. First, the ABMC was not supposed to be involved in domestic commemoration. The ABMC had been set up in 1923 as the agent of American memorialization abroad. So this was a departure, actually, from the ABMC's mission. The other interesting issue is that this was the first memorial, this memorial that's planned for John J. Pershing in Washington, D.C., this is the first memorial that would be funded entirely with private donations. All of those memorials that you just saw on the Western Front were created through American tax dollars. And one thing that the architects of Pershing's memory in the nation's capital quickly learned is that it's one thing to spend tax dollars, it's quite a different proposition to have your memorial dependent upon the generosity of the American public. As a result of these issues, the development of the memorial for Pershing in Washington, D.C. drags on for decades, and the site is not completed until 1983. Ultimately, two walls are put in place that are inscribed with the achievements of the American Expeditionary Forces, and then a statue of Pershing, not on a horse, and with a very low pedestal, is added to the site. Here's what the finished memorial looks like. It's got to be one of the most hideous memorials in all of Washington, D.C. When you first look at it, you can't believe it's Pershing. The likeness is awful. And it looks actually, if I were to show this to someone who could ignore the American flag in the background, they'd probably think that it's Lenin, and it's located in Moscow. Just absolutely hideous. And to further add to the ironies here, as soon as this memorial was completed in 1983, it quickly fell into neglect. When I first visited this memorial in the late 1980s, there were homeless people sleeping at the edge of the walls, and there were crack vials on the bench facing Pershing's statue. What were some of the issues? Well, there was the issue of funding, which I've mentioned, but there also was the issue of various urban renewal projects on Pennsylvania Avenue that kept shifting the guidelines in terms of what was permissible. And so as a result, the height of Pershing's statue was ultimately lowered by several feet. The walls were less imposing than they would have been otherwise, and all of this had to be adjusted based on the demands of city planners in the nation's capital. This is the Pershing statue, which was actually added to the site 2 years after it first opened. It opened in 1981, and then in 1983, this statue was added. So I would say that the commemorative enterprise on the part of the ABMC to secure Pershing's foothold on the American memorial landscape of DC was, again, a failure. And a memory project that failed to attain purchase in the minds of very many Americans, and thus parallels the personal experiences debacle and also Pershing's leadership of the ABMC. But there are several additional ironies that I want to quickly cover. The Pershing Memorial, also known as the American Expeditionary Forces Memorial, is located in what's known as Pershing Park in DC, located just a few blocks from the White House. And as I'm sure you are all aware, this will be the site of the new National World War I Memorial, if and when it's ever completed. I would argue that the memory malaise that is attached to Pershing has spilled over into this project, which was supposed to be dedicated in 2018 on Veterans Day, but now it's projected that it will take until 2024 to complete this memorial due to a whole host of factors, the funding issue. You might be interested to know that the United States World War I Centennial Commission, which oversaw the design and construction of this memorial, did not receive a penny of public funds. And I can say that with some authority since I was one of the historical advisors for that commission. It was impoverished to begin with. And this created all kinds of challenges for this memorial. Now, the central component of this memorial, the most dramatic component, is this extraordinary 60-foot-long bas relief sculpture by the American sculptor Sabin Howard. I'm quite fond of it. A lot of people think that it's not effective. I think it's a quite striking sculpture, and I like the way that it evokes really the aesthetic qualities of the World War I era. This piece is titled A Soldier's Journey, and it follows a man's passage through war, moving left to right. But there's yet another irony. We already have a National World War I Memorial. You're seated in it. In 2004, the Liberty Memorial in Kansas City received the designation from Congress as the National World War I Museum. 10 years later, President Barack Obama authorized the Liberty Memorial to be designated not only the National World War I Museum, but also the National World War I Memorial. So we're now in a situation in which America's so-called forgotten war is now going to have two national memorials. One of them, if this is ever completed in Washington, one of them in the nation's capital, the other one right here at D.C. If that doesn't tell us something about the unsettled, fractured, and ambiguous memory of this conflict in American culture, I don't know what does. But I do need to add just a couple quick further examples of some irony involving Pershing and his place in American memory. I hate to do this to you, but I will. Yes, in 2020, John J. Pershing was played by none other than actor Ron Perlman, featured here on the left-hand side of the screen. Ron Perlman, you may remember as the eponymous character of the television series Beauty and the Beast. Ron Perlman played the Beast, of course. And how on earth he was cast as John J. Pershing is a mystery that would bear investigation. Of all of the people who could play, nothing against Ron Perlman, but of all the people who could play Pershing, it's a striking choice. I end this presentation by paying tribute to John J. Pershing, the general of the armies who survived the pressure cooker of American involvement of World War I and led American forces to victory on the Western Front. Pershing was clearly a triumphant figure, a victor on the political, diplomatic, and military battlefield of American intervention in that war. But I would argue that on the battlefield of memory, he has fared less well. Thank you. I'll certainly entertain any questions if anyone has any.
This microphone, there we go. Steve Trout, thank you so very much.
Sure.
Now we have perfect. We've got an on-site audience who has questions with an index cards. Because we have an on-site speaker, we also do have these live microphones. If you choose to, you may come down. But we've got Greg, who is with us this year as an intern, and many of you already know Haley. They will be grabbing those questions for you. If you are online, you can put those questions into the chat. So, Steve, your first question is it a given or accepted fact that General Funston would have led the AEF in World War I instead of Pershing if he, Funston, had lived in 1917? That is a what if. I like it. Go for it.
I don't know. The rival for leadership of the AEF that I can speak a little bit about was Leonard Wood. And there was a real possibility that Leonard Wood might have been selected to lead American forces abroad. There were a whole host of reasons why he wasn't selected. Unlike Pershing, he was seen as a political general. There were questions about Leonard Wood's health, whether he would be physically able to endure the strain of command. I've heard the argument about Funston before, but I'm just not in a position to address that. By the way, in Pershing's memoir, in my experiences in the World War, one of the many things that he says that just ain't so is he claims that he was completely shocked when he was selected to lead the AEF, that he had expected no more than the command perhaps of a division, and Pershing was an extremely ambitious individual, and this just flies in the face of everything that we know about him. But no, his command of the AEF was not a given. I can't really speak to Funston, but definitely Leonard Wood was considered.
You already allude to this next question. How honest, both with his readers and really with himself, was Pershing in his 2-volume memoir?
Well, I think a better question is maybe, is any memoir ever honest? Some of you may recall the big hullabaloo some decades ago when a book that was part of the Oprah Book Club selections called A Million Little Pieces was an account of a former drug addict. And an awful lot of what was asserted in that memoir turned out not to be accurate, and the author had to appear on Oprah and apologize to the American public. My reaction to that as a literary scholar was, and what else is new? Memoirs are notoriously unreliable, and if you have ever tried to write about your own life, which is an interesting exercise, you very quickly get befuddled. Did I really experience this? Is this a false memory? Is this something that I've created that didn't occur at all? So I think that all memoirs are fundamentally problematic. One of the issues with Pershing's 2-volume work is that he based it on journal entries, but in some cases the journal entries didn't really exist. So he had to go back and talk with people he had served with in AEF headquarters to verify details. I don't really see that as outright fictionalizing. I think Pershing was trying the best he could to be accurate. Of course, one of the problems with my experiences in the World War is the book is so dull that you lose interest after a while in whether or not he's being accurate or not. But I think that any work of autobiography is fundamentally suspect, and it always contains fictionalizing. I think this is completely unavoidable. Even with the best of intentions, no one ever captures their own life with full authenticity. But I think Pershing made an effort. He did fact check as best he could. He worked on this thing endlessly. And one of the differences between Pershing and Grant is that Grant was able to provide this crystal clear prose. It just flowed from his pen. You know, Twain claimed that Grant's work didn't need much editing. Pershing, if you actually look at the manuscript pages of his work, the writing gets worse the more he revises. You know, that's a terrible message for students. I'm always trying to get them to revise their work. But Pershing probably would have been well advised to just leave it alone when he first got it out there. Yeah. Another question, please.
Another question specifically about writing.
Yeah.
The question is really about the quality of writing, which was an interesting one. How did the quality of Pershing's military orders and other wartime writings compare with his memoir, that it is in fact a different type of writing style?
It's a different type of writing, and that was a type of writing with which Pershing had extensive experience and handled pretty well. I don't think there were real communication problems when he issued orders and when he drew up memos during his command. He was perfectly comfortable with that. But I think it's fair to say that once he turned to a very, very different genre of writing, he just felt out of his depth and at times paralyzed. To write a narrative of one's military career during a world war is a fundamentally different proposition than writing utilitarian pieces of prose that need to communicate to soldiers your specific orders and demands. So I think to say that Pershing was a horrible writer, if I can qualify that, I think that applies to his work on my experiences in the World War. I don't think it was necessarily true of his other writings at all.
Your next question is going to be coming from a Zoom member and read to us by James Taub.
Wonderful.
Scott Ramage asks, are there any descendants of General Pershing that are involved in preserving his memory?
That's an excellent question. You know, his grandson served in multiple conflicts, and exactly where the Pershing family is today, I just don't know. I'll have to confess my ignorance on that. That's a really, really interesting question, and it's a question that would be worth exploring, I think, given my argument that Pershing's stock value as a recognizable American celebrity has sort of fallen over the last half century or so. I just don't know. That's a really good question. Yeah.
Your question that leads to our a combination of two questions,
yeah,
which is to speak a little bit about how Pershing was viewed in the 30s and the 40s,
yeah,
within the United States military.
Well, I think he was justly venerated by a lot of people, but I also think that Pershing kind of fades from the national scene. You know, it's interesting that when the United States enters the Second World War, he was really sidelined. There wasn't any significant effort to involve Pershing in war planning or to have him speak to the lessons that could be drawn from the American experience of World War I. And of course, Pershing was quite elderly by that point, but was still in remarkably good health and still mentally sharp. So I think Pershing was a person who just wasn't really seen as relevant, I think, through a lot of American life. You know, he entered the he entered the race for the Republican presidential nomination in 1920 very, very late. And he was on the fence about this. Did he want to run or not? Was he really interested in politics? And by the time he threw his hat in the ring, really it was too late for him to make any difference. A lot of people have argued, though, that even if Pershing had made a more robust attempt to run for office, he wouldn't have been elected, apart because veterans of the American Expeditionary Forces, by and large, didn't like him. They respected him without question, but they didn't like him. You know, Pershing's personality, I think, is another issue in these failed commemorative attempts. Pershing was a bit of a cold fish. He was a task driver. He did not have a warm rapport with most of the soldiers who worked with him at Chaumont, at the AEF headquarters. He did have a warm and boyish side. He did have a sense of humor, but he tended to save that for people who were part of his intimate circle. So I'm sure Micheline Rescu, with whom he had a relationship from 1918 until his death, probably saw a side of Pershing that would have been completely unfamiliar to his soldiers. So he just didn't have the best reputation. Pershing did have an ability to say, as Donald Smythe points out in his biography, Pershing had the ability to say the right thing at the right time, but he wasn't a person who delighted in public speaking. He was like Grant in this regard. Grant absolutely hated public speaking. It was something he never felt he was good at, and he never felt comfortable with. And I think some of that discomfort you also see in Pershing. Yeah.
One of our audience members says, perhaps the greatest victory from Pershing and the ABMC was the publication of the 1938 book, American Armies and Battlefields in Europe. In this
yes.
country and in Europe, this is still a Bible for battlefield visits to World War I. I do love that this person actually did say, this is just a comment. So thank you for that. It is a really nice introduction to another question that was right here.
Could I respond to that one real quickly?
You certainly can.
That comment?
Yeah.
It's a tribute not only to Pershing's leadership of the ABMC, it's also a tribute to Dwight D. Eisenhower. Eisenhower wrote most of that guidebook. He did so as a ghostwriter when he was working in the historical section of the ABMC. Pershing was, Eisenhower rather, was absolutely instrumental in the creation of the original ABMC guidebook that was published in 1926, as I recall. And then he helped with the expansion of that 1926 edition into that wonderful 1938 book, which remains, I absolutely agree, one of the essential books on American military performance in the First World War. But I just want to make that connection. So we have not only Pershing connected to that, but also Dwight D. Eisenhower in an interesting and little known way. Yeah.
All right. We are down to our last two questions.
Okay.
Back to the ABMC. How did the Germans treat the ABMC cemeteries during their occupation 1940 to 1944?
By and large, respectfully. And, you know, after the invasion of Western Europe by Nazi Germany, you know, the United States was not embroiled in the conflict yet. And so there were opportunities for officers who represented the ABMC to go to Vichy, France, and personally observe the state of American memorials. And I don't know of any instance in which an ABMC memorial was intentionally desecrated by the Germans. There were instances in which memorials were hit by artillery fire and by bullets, and repairs had to be made later. But by and large, the Germans, when they occupied France in the Second World War, treated these sites with a good deal of respect.
Yeah. And if you have joined us on one of the National World War I Museum and Memorial Battlefield Tours, mm-hmm. That actually is a part of a visit, and a part of that program is to be able to
cool.
look and have some of those conversations. I'll tell you some more information about that a little bit later cool. in our symposium. The last question comes from Rhonda Ireland of Lee Summit West. Do you think lack of interest in American memorialization in Europe was more so due to U.S.'s return to isolation, the Great Depression, or something else?
I'd say all of the above in the case of the Depression and isolationism. And I would also add my point about how the aesthetic agenda of the ABMC didn't necessarily match up well, I think, with what individual American veterans of the war wanted to see.
Wonderful. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please join me in thanking Dr. Stephen Trout.